Hello everybody, this is a tutorial on StumpWM. So let's get started. Alright, right now I'm on a different window manager. For example, if you're on Ubuntu, you'll be on GNOME. Right now in my case, I'm on DWM, but it doesn't really matter. So first of all, I'll walk through how to install StumpWM. So first you should open up your terminal, then whatever your package manager is. So in my case, since I'm on Arc, I would use Pacman, or from the AUR, I would use Yay. Yeah, I'll just actually zoom in. There we go. Hopefully you can see this a bit better. So in my case, I'll use Pacman, or I'll use Yay as my package manager. Wait, oh no, yeah, I'll just open it anymore. All right, there it is. So first of all, you need to actually install StumpWM. So Yay-S, StumpWM works for me. So first of all, if I just search it up, in my case, there's StumpWM itself, and then there's StumpWM-contrib-git. I should probably get that. It will be important in using lots of additional packages for StumpWM, such as having gaps, some better support, and some other stuff. So you'll want two packages, StumpWM and StumpWM-contrib-git. So I'm gonna quickly get contrib-git. I already have StumpWM installed, so this will just take a minute. Also, by the way, if you're on Ubuntu or some other distribution, so let me just open up my browser here. StumpWM contrib-git. Right, oh, there it is. Okay, I'll just type my password. Okay, it's installing. So you should go over here. You can probably git clone it. There should be a tutorial in installing it, something like that. So you'll just have to install this plus the base StumpWM, which I'm pretty sure is in the default app git repositories. All right, so once you have StumpWM installed and StumpWM-contrib-git, you should be good to go. Now let's begin with some basic configuration. The reason I'm not using StumpWM's default configuration is, for me at least, it's quite unbearable. Its default configuration is honestly just really bad in my opinion. So first I'm gonna change some defaults of it, and then we'll actually load into StumpWM. I'll show the keybinds and all that. So let's quickly create the default config. Let's create a nice configuration that we can work off from. So first of all, you have to go into your .config directory, and then you can do make dir stumpwm. Okay, I'm gonna cd into it. So I'm going into that directory with cd. Right, so I created the directory stumpwm in config, and the file that it's gonna read off of is the file config. So in .config in stumpwm, the file it reads off is config. Right, so I'm gonna just I'm gonna vim that. You can use whatever editor you want, if you use Emacs or whatever. All right, so now let's actually edit this file. Now I'm gonna just quickly bring up my old StumpWM configuration, as I don't really remember it. This is the wrong one. StumpWM-config.lisp. All right. So this is my old configuration. I'm just gonna use this as reference, as I don't really remember everything by heart. So first of all, the first thing you'll want to do is do in package stumpwm. This just basically lets you know you're gonna use the package, you're gonna use functions from StumpWM's, from the StumpWM thing. You need this, is quite important. You can also quickly set the file type equals lisp. All right, there we go. Now syntax highlighting should be on. So just gonna save this. Now, here's some base stuff that we should probably do. So when StumpWM boots up, I'm gonna run a shell command. So run shell command. Also, just remember this is written in common Lisp. So it can be quite weird with all the brackets for someone who's never used any Lisp before. But if you guys want a quick tutorial, I strongly recommend this. So if I just do a common Lisp tutorial, this is just gonna take a second to load. You guys can watch this video. It's quite long, but it teaches everything about everything about Lisp really well. So you'll be completely ready to do whatever you want in Lisp and really customize it, rather than just like not really knowing what you're doing and copy-pasting from others' configurations. So I strongly suggest learning Lisp. It's fine if you don't, but it's just good to know when you're working with a Lisp-based window manager. All right, so first of all, I'm gonna run the shell command sh --xprofile. Now, I'll just quickly explain what this does. Now, most people have an xprofile, so I'm just gonna open this up. bin.xprofile, right? This is just like lots of things you wanna do by default on startup. So if I just zoom in here. So for example, I wanna start pcom. That's how to make your windows transparent. This is specifically when I'm on DWM, but it doesn't matter. I wanna set my set caps lock to escape and some other things, set a wallpaper with a custom script that I have. Thing is, with StumpWM, it's sort of, I don't know how this really works, but even though it runs, it does its own stuff after it runs the dot, the X init RC, which causes some problems. So I strongly just recommend having this just because why not, right? So run shell command sh --xprofile. All right, once you've done that, let me just quickly bring this here. Now you'll want some default variables. So over here, this is my my actual configuration that's already set up. I have some variables on these lines here on some default stuff. So first of all, I'll want the messages to come into the center of the gravity, into the center of the window rather than like the bottom left or something. I'll want the input window, so when it asks for input, to come onto the center, the borders to be thin, padding to be 10, just some other default configurations, the float window border to be 4, and some other things. So what I'm just gonna do in my case is I'm gonna copy this into my configuration. This is just some, you know, some basic stuff. Let me just close this right now. There we go. Right, this is just some basic configuration. Let me just quickly reorder this. All right. Okay, so also, by the way, if you don't want to write this by hand, you can copy paste this. I'm going to have a GitHub link for all the progress done here. All right, then moving on, we'll skip the fonts part for now. We'll do that later. I'm just going to scroll down and see what else we have to do. All right, so first of all, we'll probably want to get this thing set up. So what I'm going to do is run shell command xmod map dash e clear mod 4. I can just copy paste it from there, but why not just write it out here so I can explain what's happening. So this basically clears the super key. So I'm assuming for this you'll want to use the super key as your prefix key. So the way StumpWM works is it has a prefix key. So after you type that prefix key, you can type in your commands. Now you can set this to whatever you want, right? So the default is something weird like control T. But for me, I feel like every single command, prefixing that with control T feels really weird. So personally, I like to have it binded as the super key. So I can press super and then the command. It just feels a lot more natural, especially coming from window managers such as DWM, the one I'm on right now, and some other window managers. So this is a small hack to make the super key, the prefix key, since it's hard to do that with built-in. So first of all, xmodmap is a utility that can be installed from the package manager, but is installed in most distributions by default, unless you're on Arch, then you should probably install this xmodmap, right? So what I'm doing is I'm clearing the current binding of the super key. Then what I'm gonna do is run shell command xmodmap-e key code 133 equals F20. I found this in DistroTube's configuration, this hack to get the super key. I strongly suggest looking at his configuration. It has some decent defaults, however, I'm hoping to dive a bit further since his is still quite like basic. Some of the stuff are also a bit buggy in his configuration, so I'm hoping to dive further. All right, anyways, so let's quickly look at what this does. So what this does is it takes xmodmap and then it binds. So 133 is just the super key, that's like the area super key is located, to F20. So whenever you press the super key, instead of actually pressing the super key, it presses F20. Now, the reason we're going to do this is we're going to set the prefix key to keyboard F20, right? Keyboard F20. Now, what this does is it essentially binds your super key to F20 and then sets the prefix key to F20. For some reason or another, we can't straight up bind the super key to the prefix key, which is S. But this is a simple workaround, and it gets the job done perfectly fine. All right, let's move on, right? So first of all, we want groups. By default, StumpWM only contains one group. A group is like a workspace or like tags in DWM. By default, StumpWM only has one group, but you can add more. So in my case, I'm just gonna add a few more. So first of all, let's create a variable. So I'm just gonna put, let's just do aj/workspaces. Or in our case, I'll just do CE as a short form for codeexplode/workspaces, right? And then over here, so we're defining a variable with this. By the way, the reason I'm putting stars around is it's just good form to have your global variables with stars around them. It's just good form. That's like how you're supposed to do in Lisp. All right, and then I'm gonna assign that variable to a list of all the workspaces I want. So in my case, I already have it here, but I'm just gonna retype it, because why not? So a www code term, right? Let's just have that. You can have something like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. In my case, I only really need 3 workspaces on average. So www code terminal, those are my 3 workspaces. You can have as many as you want again, but I do not need them. All right, so the way I'm just gonna quickly do is StumpWM-group rename. I'm gonna quickly explain what this does after. You know what, I'll just copy this here and paste it above. All right, so what this does is the default workspace that's already added to StumpWM is called something like default. What I'm first doing is I'm renaming the renaming the group we're currently highlighted on, the default workspace, to the zeroth or the first value of my workspaces. So it'll be renamed to www. And now I'm gonna do a simple sort of iteration thing. So I'll just quickly explain cdr star rv/workspaces. Right, StumpWM-newBGWorkspace. Alright, by the way, the way I know all these commands are, they're all in the documentation. I strongly suggest looking at that. I'll even give a link in the description. StumpWM documentation. I don't know if this will give it. Oh, it is. Okay, perfect. StumpWMDocumentation.com. You can even get the HTML or the PDF documentation, and you have practically everything. So if I want to get more information on how to work with groups, I can just click groups, and there's a really nice manual here. You get all the different functions you can do, the variables and stuff. I'm just trying to make it easier to actually get started with the configuration. So over here, what this does is it goes through the list of workspaces, right? And all it does is it keeps getting the first value of, it keeps getting, how do I explain this? So what does it do? Yeah, it keeps basically getting each value of, Yeah, basically what it does is goes through each value of the workspaces, right? That's what this part does. And then it creates a new workspace for with that name. Now, why did I do CDR Adi workspace? Or wait, this should all be named to codeexplode/workspace, angetil/CE/workspace. All right, there we go. Now, the reason I did CDR CE-workspace is we need to leave out the first workspace since we already did that over here, right? Since that's a rename while the rest have to be newly made. So CDR basically gets all the values of the list except the first one. So it'll just get all of these values because the first one is already taken care of here. And then for each of those values, it creates a new workspace with that name. So essentially, this entire block of code first renames the default workspace to www. Then for each value in the list, so for code and terminal, it creates a new workspace with that name. So at the end of it, you'll have just whatever the list is here. And the nice part about this is you can have as many workspaces as possible, and it'll just work. You don't have to do any other adjusting. So you can just change the value of this list, and everything will work. It's fine if you don't really understand this code. It won't matter too much, but that's why I slightly suggest watching the video on Lisp. It'll help you with these kind of stuff. All right, now moving on. So this block of code is a bit more confusing. I'll copy-paste it, then go through it. Now this lets you move to the workspaces with super 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and so on. Right. So first of all, what this essentially does is it creates a variable called move to key bindings. It then assigns it to a list of 1, 2. If you look at shift 1, what that outputs. So if I do shift 1, that's an exclamation mark. Shift 2 is @. Shift 3 is # You see what I mean, right? So I basically assigned. If you want to move a window to another workspace on a normal window manager, I'm used to doing something like super shift 2, right? And it's moved to the second workspace. If I want to bring it back, super shift 1, right? And it's moved back to the first one. Now in StumpWM, you don't do something like shift dash and then the thing. Instead, you do the actual output of that. So what is actually shift 1 on the keyboard? It results in an exclamation mark. So all I'm creating is a variable with all the different key binds to move to. So if shift 1 is exclamation mark, shift 2 is @, shift 3 is # Let me just delete that space. Shift 4 is $, and so on. So I do that from 1 through 9. And these are the different keybinds that I use to move windows around through different workspaces. Then over here, I basically repeat something a multiple times. So I do times y to the length of the number of workspaces. This should all be just changed to CE/workspaces, and there we go. All right, so after that, let's then do let workspace write to string. All right, for these stuff, you don't really need to worry about it, but all it does is it binds the different workspaces to super 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and it binds moving windows to other workspaces to super shift 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? Also, there is some notation we should talk about. If I want to create a key binding, I do something like this. So define dash key, right? That's the function. Then root map. Now, what root map tells you is the map you're addressing. So by default, there's like root map, top map, and a few others. Root map basically does, after your prefix key, runs a certain thing. So after I press the super key, in my case, then I can bind stuff to root map. Then all the things that I've binded to root map get accessed. So if I do root map, then you need in other brackets keyboard and the thing you want to be pressed. So let's say A, right? Root map A. And let's say I want that to bring up my web browser. So exec brave, right? And actually let's bind that to W. So what this means is after I press super, since we're talking about root map, so after I press super, and then the key W, it executes brave. So over here, I give the command it wants to execute. So I'm calling on the command that's already made by StumpWM called execute, and then I can give it a shell command over here. So in my case, the shell command brave, so if I just open a new terminal and type in brave, it opens up brave. It opens up my browser. So it executes the shell command brave. That's the command. And by this way, I've essentially created a new binding that does super w opens up brave. It's the same way I've created key bindings here, except I've just added some additional Lisp syntax, which if you don't understand, again, it's fine. I won't go over it here. It's not too complex though. All right, now let's keep going. So here we are, right? That's some basics. Now let's move on. Now over here, I have lots of key bindings. So first of all, I'm just gonna take all of these and copy them. I'll quickly explain what they do here. Yeah, just ignore this for a second. Let me just quickly fix all of these stuff. There we go. All right. Now, over here, I've copy-pasted lots of key bindings that should make it a lot easier to navigate through Windows. So what this is, if you remember, is so after you press the super key, that's for root map, and then you press shift and Q, right? So capital Q, shift and Q, it quits StumpWM. So it exits StumpWM and it logs you out. If you press super shift R, so if you press super shift R, super capital R, it restarts StumpWM. If you press super C, it goes into command mode. Wait, I'll just delete that for now. We don't need to worry about that right now. Super Q deletes the window. So it basically just quits the window as if, like, if I open a new thing here in DWM, I bind it to super Q. Some people like to have it on super shift C, some other thing. I prefer super Q. It's up to you. Super R removes the window. It removes the current frame. Now, this is a StumpWM concept that I'll talk about later once I actually am on StumpWM. All right, let's keep going. So super H moves the focus to left. So super H goes to the window on my left. Super J moves the focus down. Super K moves focus up. These are just normal sort of Vim key bindings that any Vim user would like. If you prefer to use the arrow keys, you can just completely delete these, or you can just delete it, since StumpWM by default has the arrow key binded to the same thing. In my case, I prefer to use Vim keys. I find the arrow keys way too hard to reach on average and normal usage, right? And let's just move on. So soon we're going to get to actually we're soon gonna get to going on to StumpWM and seeing how to use it. Right now we're just creating the configuration to make it a lot easier. Alright, so first of all, I set a variable that's already created to 50. That's the resize increment. So I want every time I resize a window to resize it by an increment of 50. That's up to personal preference. You can just try out different variables. For me, 50 works just fine. 50 pixels, that works perfectly. Now over here, I have a defined key top map alt L alt H alt K alt J. So M just stands for alt, right? Now, why did I do top map instead of root map? The difference this makes is top map is called from anywhere. So with all of these key bindings, I first have to press the super key, then I press the key binding, and that's how it works. However, with top map, it can be called without pressing the super key. You can just do it from whenever time. So this makes it a lot easier rather than typing the super key L just to resize, since you have to often call the resize function multiple times to get the windows resized to the way you want. So that's just some personal preference. So if you type Alt H, you do not need to press the super key at all, then it just resizes the windows. All right, so resizing the windows is worked out. Now quickly, let's just create one last key binding to open up the simple terminal. You can do this to whatever terminal you want. If you're on GNOME by default, I think it's gnome-terminal, right? Yeah, you can just do, instead of meet spawning st, which is my terminal, I use st, that's my terminal of choice. You can use something like GNOME terminal, Alacrity, whatever you use. All right, so keyboard, so define key, root map, keyboard, right? Let's bind it to return key. So when I press super return, it opens up the simple terminal, execst. Now, we already went over the syntax with brave over here. In fact, I'm just going to quickly bring that over here. Right, so we bind root map, so after you press the super key, then if you press the return key, it brings up the simple terminal. If you press the super key, then press W, it brings up Brave, the web browser. Alright, so that's about it for the configuration. I'm going to quickly log out, go on to StumpWM with this default configuration, and we'll go on from there. Hello, everybody. So currently, I just logged on to the StumpWM configuration we just made. Now, you might not have this wallpaper. It's just something I have in my X profile, which is where I run it. So over here, if I just zoom in, right, it's something I have in my X profile. You don't need to worry about it right now. You probably will have a gray screen or something along those lines. Anyways, let's move on. So currently, the way my StumpWM works is if you first press super shift question mark, you can bring up all the different commands you can type, right? So super question mark, so super shift /, in my case, brings up all the commands. Now, the reason, just remember, every single time I press the super key, it'll actually show F20, since that's what we've binded it to. But in reality, I'm just pressing the super key. All right, so now this is something that's really, really nice about StumpWM. I can see all the different commands I can press. So let's say I want to bring up a terminal like I just did earlier. So in our case, we binded it to super return. And you can even see in this help menu, our custom bindings are over here. So super ret, it does execute st, right? So super, so you can see over here, keys F20, and then return, super return. And I have my simple terminal pulled up. Now, I do not think you guys would have this keys thing over here, since it's a custom function that I added behind the scenes just so it'll make it easier to follow what I'm doing. You guys don't need to worry about it. I just added that, and yeah, so just escape that. Now, every single time, for example, if you type a bad key binding, it's going to prompt you. Now, here's something sort of weird about StumpWM, which is also what makes it really cool, in my opinion. It's just really different from other tiling window managers. Let's say I open Super W, which I bind it to, the Brave browser, as we saw earlier. Now, it doesn't lay them out in any sort of way. Instead, it brings it over it. And you might be wondering, wait, I thought this was a tiling window manager. Why is everything going in full screen? Well, the way it works is there are windows and there are frames. I'm not too sure. I might be mixing them up. But windows are basically the actual windows. So the terminal window I have pulled up here, Brave browser I have here. But there's only one current frame over here. But there's only one frame. So there's only one sort of frame. If I want more frames, I can split the current frame into two frames. So by default, it's binded to S and Shift S. So super S splits it horizontally. So now I have two frames, one of each of my different windows pulled up here. Right. So now I have two frames. I can remove a frame using super R. This is a custom key binding we added. Right. So super R removes a frame. Now the window is still there. The terminal is still alive and running, right? But we just can't see it since there's only one frame. Let's say I do super shift S. That splits it vertically. And as you can see, the simple terminal is still here. It just was hidden from view. Let's say I want to actually quit something. I want to quit a window. Let's say I do not want the simple terminal process to still be running. I can do super Q. Now, that quits the window, but the frame doesn't go away. The frame's still here. In this case, it's just empty, right? So, and let's say I want to bring up another instance of my browser over here. So, super W brings it up on the current frame you're highlighted on. Now you can have as many frames as you want and as many windows. So let's say I split it again, right? Oh no, this is, wait, 1 second, I'm sorry. This is my recording. I'm just gonna quickly move this out of here. There we go. That was just my recording. Wait, just excuse me for a second. I'm sorry about that. That was my recording terminal pulled up. But now, as you can see over here, we don't really have any windows in this frame. However, we can move a window into this frame. So let's say I want this web browser to be over here, right? I can do super shift J, and that brings it down here. Super shift K brings it back up. Let's say I want to move, let's say I want to change my focus to this. I can just move my cursor and then click on this frame over here, or I can just do super L, super H, or even the arrow keys work perfectly fine. The arrow keys are binded by default. H, J, K, L, I binded customly with my own key bindings. Right, so super arrow keys can move them around. Super shift J, super shift K can move them up and down, can actually move the windows. So let's say I want this window to reach over here. Right, I want this window to occupy this frame. Super shift L. Now currently, this is pretty funny. They're all on the same frame. They're multiple windows. They're just all on the same frame. Now I can just super shift J to now move it on the frame underneath. And as you can see, there are two windows here. Now let's say, oh, okay, I do not need this frame anymore. I can go super H to select the frame on my right and remove it. Now I have both of my windows as a sort of horizontal thing. Now let's say, you know what, I changed my mind. I in fact want both of my windows to be vertically split. So I can do super shift S. Remember, super shift S vertically splits the current frame, and super S horizontally splits it. Let's just quickly remove that. Right now I can move this window into that frame. So super shift L. Now I have this window in that frame. I can go down, so super J to select the bottom thing, and I can simply remove this, right? Now, let's say let's just remove this, right? Now, let's say I wanna access my other Brave browser instance. Now, that you might think, oh, I have to split it. Well, one of the amazing things about StumpWM is you can simply access, they're called your hidden windows, since I can't see my other Brave browser instance, but it is certainly running, with super N and super P. So super N for next and super P for previous. So super N leads me here. If I also press super N again, since there are only two windows, it goes to the next one. Now, if I split these, you can see it's still there. However, if I actually quit this, it is gone for good, right? Now let's say I remove this, and now I have one window, one frame. Now let's do a super shift S, so vertically splits it, super L, and let's spawn the terminal, right? So let's execute, so super enter, and I have my terminal. Now let's say I have multiple instances of the terminal. So let's say ls, cd downloads, this is just in my downloads directory, right? Now let's spawn another terminal, right? As you can see, there are three windows now. There are two terminal instances and the Brave browser, but only two frames. Now, let's say I want to access my other terminal right now. I can do super N to cycle through the hidden windows. So super N, super N. And I can keep cycling through them, right? Let's say I want all of the windows to be visible. So I want to horizontally split this to have like sort of a master and stack layout kind of thing. So now I press super S to horizontally split it, and the window has automatically appeared here. The hidden window has been filled up. And let's say I want to split this again. So super shift S, I can select this and do super enter, and boom, another terminal gets spawned over there. I can quit that. Let's remove these frames, remove that. And in fact, let's just quit this. Right, Now let's go to our configuration of Lisp of StumpWM. So cd StumpWM and vim config, right? I'm just gonna zoom in here. Set file type equals Lisp. There we go. Now, as you can see here, some of our custom bindings are coming into play. So that's how we quit the windows, super Q and super R. By default, I think removing the windows, I'm not even too sure what the default key binding is, but deleting the windows is binded to super K, but I wanted those to be my Vim key bindings. So I just changed most of the key bindings around. Now, as I said earlier, for the top map key bindings, you don't actually need to press the super key. So if I just press Alt L and Alt H, I can simply resize the windows without having to press the super key beforehand. So I can resize the windows, say super S to split it. Let's have a new instance. And I want this bottom window, this terminal over here, to be a lot bigger. Oh wait, sorry, wrong thing here. And let's just make it bigger. Oh no, super L to make it bigger. And there we go. As you can see now, this thing is huge. And whatever, let's just quit the window and close the frame. There we go. So super Q and then super R. And well, yep, those are the basics of StumpWM. If you guys like this video, please make sure to leave a comment, and hopefully I can create some more tutorials in the future. For now, that's about it, and well, thanks for watching. Bye.